Okay, welcome to our Arab Shabbat class. Welcome to Parashat Ki Tavoh. What is the final mitzvah in the greatest thrust and surge of mitzvot in the Torah? And how is it relevant for the awesome days that we are leading up to? You know, the Gera, the Gaon Mivilna, breaks down Parashat Sefer Devarim into three different categories. The second and middle of those categories is what he titles in one word, mitzvot. Really beginning from the Aseret Diberot, the Ten Commandments in Parashat Vayetchanan, and going through the beginning of our parasha, so in volume, it's most of the book of Devarim. The parashiot are all about Moshe Rabbeinu going over, reviewing some, and also issuing an information on some new mitzvot we haven't learned yet. However, in the prior three parashiot, in the parashiot which precede Ki Tabor, there is an absolute powerful surge of mitzvot, one of the like of which we have never seen in the Torah. Namely, from Parashiot, Re'eh, Shofetim, and Ki Teseh, there are a grand total of 170 mitzvot in those three parashiot alone, which add up to nearly 30% of the mitzvot in the Torah, and then culminate with a few mitzvot in the beginning of Parashat Ki Tabor. That is what I call a surge or a thrust of mitzvot, one like there is no other in the entire Torah. And the last of this section, if you will, of the book of Devarim, before the last final section of the book of Devarim, is a mitzvah. And a mitzvah that although we can't practically relate to in our days, one in which the theme is so poignantly and in an uncanny manner, fitting and relevant to what we are experiencing right now and what we're leading up to, which is the final grand day of Yom Kippur. I'm referring to a mitzvah that is known as Vidui Ma'aser, the confession of Ma'aser. It's actually not titled that in the Torah itself. If you're following, we're going to read a couple of pesukim and talk about this mitzvah. It's Parashat Ki Tavoh, the book of Devarim, Perek Kavav, Pasuk Yud Bet, and the following several pesukim. It happens to be that in our Bet Torah Mishnah program, some of us have just completed the subject that is found at the end of Masechet Ma'aser Sheni in Seder Zera'im. So the Torah tells us, when you finish removing ma'aser from all your produce in the third year, shenat ma'aser, the year of ma'aser, you gave to all the needy people. What is this referring to? Well, we know that someone who has produce, profits off his property, his land, his business, has to separate certain amounts and give them, offer them as a gift to certain parties. We know there's 2% rabbinically going to the Kohen's called Turuma. We know there's 10% afterwards going to the Levi. We know that years 3 and 6 of the Shemitah, the sabbatical cycle, there's another 10% called Ma'aser Ani, going to the Ani. So between Turuma, Ma'aser, and Ma'aser Ani on those 2 years, 22% of your wealth, not 10, 22% of your wealth goes to what you can call charity or communal offerings. Not to mention the Ma'aser Sheni, another 10% which you own, but you must eat in Yerushalayim, and other gifts and offerings as well. And some of these are annual, and some of these, as we said, are a couple of years in the sabbatical cycle. However, one is obligated in all of them. And at the end of, here the Torah is telling us, the third year in the Shemitah, the 7-year sabbatical cycle, one is responsible for something called bi'ur, which means I may have put aside some terumah for my neighbor, the Kohen, or some ma'aser for my friend, the Levi, but for some reason, I haven't contacted him yet, I haven't crossed his path, it's been sitting in my home, and I'm waiting, or maybe I've been lazy and negligent, and I haven't even separated it yet. Whatever the case may be, there comes a time that the buck stops here, and that is after 3 years in the Shemitah cycle, and actually Hachamim teach us that it's actually the following Pesach, which is in the middle of the 4th year of the Shemitah cycle, one must rid of all of those offering and gifts, obligatory gifts, from his house, from his possession, meaning he must have given them all at this time. And then, at the end of the Pesach holiday of that year, one must do what's called, there's no name given in the Torah, but it's a declaration. It has to be done in the Beit HaMikdash, presumably to a Kohen. And you state, Bi'ati HaKodesh Min Habayit, I rid of all of these obligatory offerings from the house. I gave it to all the appropriate parties. I performed all the mitzvot that you commanded me, etc. And we go on to list how we did not violate any of the obligations and the protocols of these offerings. I removed them in the proper order. I wasn't impure when I did so, etc. This is a declaration that one must make in public, both at the end of the third or after the third, and also after the sixth, which means within the 7th year of the Shemitah cycle. Although the Torah doesn't give a title and label this procedure, Hachamim do, and the Mishnah and the Gemara and the commentators, you'll see a two-word phrase. It's called vidui ma'aseh, the confession of ma'aseh. What is unique about this mitzvah? There is no other mitzvah in the entire Torah which you have to confess, so to speak, to the fact, or declare your observance of the mitzvah. There is no other example where the Torah commands us to attest to our fulfillment of that command. Listen, I have obligations, I'm a Jew, I'm subject to God's commands, and I perform them. This mitzvah actually makes you declare and publicly what we are calling confessed vidui, that I did perform this or these mitzvot. It's very interesting. There is another mitzvah, it's called vidui, confession, that we do on Yom Kippur. The Rambam tells us, and he names it as a mitzvah, I say a positive commandment, it's an obligation for us to confess our averot to God. But there is no other example of a mitzvah that I have to confess or declare my performance, my accurate performance of a mitzvah. Of course, there are reasons offered for the purpose of this mitzvah. But what is, I think, incredibly profound, as we're going to see, that all of the reasons, or many of the reasons given for this interesting and unique mitzvah, so much align with and are appropriate for the actual mitzvah that we experience in these days in a small way, and on Yom Kippur in a grand way, called the vidui, which is the confession of our sins. And the dynamics of this mitzvah is so relevant and aligned well with the dynamics of our regular vidui and confession. Let's talk about 3 different possibilities of this mitzvah's objective. The theory of the Sefer HaChinuch. The Sefer HaChinuch explains that, you know, the leadership of Am Yisrael is primarily from the tribe, meant at least authentically to be from the tribe of Levi, the Kohanim and Leviim. They are not just the community servants, they are the hachamim, they are the guides, they are those who inspire us and role model for us to do the right thing. Those, that tribe, those people, those leaders, they must be sustained. we must make sure that they have the wherewithal to exist in their personal sustenance in order so that they can serve Am Yisrael. Their leadership depends upon us, and that's why we have Terumah and Ma'aseh and those obligatory offerings. Now, do them, fine, we're obligated to do them. They're for a grand purpose. However, the Torah wants to put a security measure in place. And Sefer HaHanuch explains that people are so hesitant to violate their word. You know, speech is what elevates us from all other beings. The human being is elevated by his ability to speak. And innately, we treasure that gift, that ability. And you know, says Sefer HaHanuch, there are people that will violate and transgress other averot. There are people that will act in the most malicious and heinous manners and perform terrible acts in this world, and still, sometimes at least, will feel very uncomfortable and resistant to actually, especially publicly, violating their own word. And that's why in this day and age, even though the moral fabric of society is declining, unfortunately, there's something called perjury, in the United States at least, where it's fearful to lie under oath. We look at it as such a severe offense. The highest people in the highest positions will lose their jobs because of this. And people are hesitant to give their word under oath or in other official settings and speak falsely and or say something which they will not or have not really done. The Torah knows this. And therefore the Torah puts us in a position, because this mitzvah is so critical and because we must sustain God's appointed leadership of Am Yisrael, there is a deterrent put in place. And that is, you know, on the back end that you're going to have to confess, you're going to have to declare your accurate and committed observance to all these obligatory offerings to this mitzvah, to these mitzvot. You know you're going to have to proclaim the vidui ma'asir, the confession, and therefore do it right. Because you don't want to be in a position, God forbid, where, of course, if you didn't actually perform these mitzvot, then you can't make the declaration. But here we are in front of the Kohen. We're embarrassed. And maybe one will step up and say the wrong thing. Well, knowing that you might be in this position and is fearful to have to proclaim something inaccurately and put you in a very precarious position, the Torah has a deterrent in place in the back end, therefore motivating you not to ever want to be in that position. And therefore giving us this vidui ma'aseh, this confession of the obligatory offerings at the two intervals in the Shemitah cycle. And the truth is, this is so true regarding the function of vidui, of confession. And the confession of Yom Kippur is something that is daunting for those of us who are honest and realistic and religious and observant, but we're faulty, we're human beings, we're flawed. We sometimes dread that moment, although it's a great opportunity, but we don't want to have to stand in that day of awe in front of Borei confessing. We have no choice. We want to ease the blow. We have a deterrent in Yom Kippur, in that if I know that I'm going to have to face HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I don't want to face him with complete guilt. I don't want to have to rely completely on that day to empty everything and to stand before God and plead for forgiveness. And therefore in advance, these days of Elul, the days of Teshuvah leading up to Yom Kippur, I will do what it takes to be observant in order so that I can stand before God and not have to feel guilty and wrongful doing so. So we do it the entire year, especially in Elul and Arseh Me Teshuvah, acts as a deterrent for us and a motivation so that when we have to step up to the plate on the big day, we'll be ready. There's another theory put forth You can call this somewhat of a unique, maybe even a radical theory about the Sforno. Why do we have to make this confession? They removed all the Turumah, Maaseh, etc. The Sforno says that this actually, by telling God that I gave the Kohen and the Levi what is coming and deservingly so coming to them, we confess and we acknowledge the fact that this was not supposed to be the case. The original peoples that were supposed to receive this distinction was or were the Bechorot, the firstborn. And they are interdispersed throughout all the tribes. It could have been me, it could have been you, it certainly could have been someone from my family and from your family. And because Het HaEgel, historically we know what happened, and everyone sinned except for tribe of Levi, and they stepped up, Mila Hashem Eli, they were chosen in lieu of the firstborns. And at this point in time, says the Sforno, the reason why we make this declaration is to declare and be cognizant and conscious of the fact that we lost what we could have had. And he says the words, although it seems to be maybe not the pshat of the words, Bi'arti ha-kodesh min ha-bayit. I rid of the holy substance from my house. It means that I rid of the opportunity to have the holy substance in my house. I could have been a chosen one. I should have been the Kohen Levi. I should have had Turumah and Maaseh delivered to my house. And yet I lost the opportunity. Painful. Regret. There is no more painful emotion that one can experience than that of regret. Because there's no turning back. Time cannot be turned back. Yes, you can make the Shabbat. Yes, you can be forgiven. Yes, you can wipe out prior deeds. But that feeling, that emotion, is so powerful. And we know that the vidui, in the vidui, and part of the teshuvah process is harata, is feeling regret and remorse for what we've done. And the function of the vidui is to get us into that mindset. What could have been, what we could have been, what we could have done. And that is, as opposed to what the world around us will say, don't get down on yourself. You really didn't make a mistake. Everything's really okay. There's no such thing as failure. There absolutely is. Acknowledging that is very healthy. Experience regret is very healthy. And that vidui is there for that purpose and makes me think I never want to have to feel this way again. I never want to have to tell myself that it should have been different. I could have done what I was supposed to do, or I could have refrained from that which I was not supposed to. It's interesting, Lahavdil. I recall a story with probably the greatest basketball player who ever lived, Michael Jordan. And in his, we was asked later in his career, what was a motivating factor for you to work so hard, to be so great? And he said in high school, he tried out for the basketball team and he didn't make the cut. He didn't make the cut. And he was cut from the tryout squad. And he said he felt so sick at that time that his dream, making the high school basketball team, didn't come true. He said, I promised myself on that day that I would never feel this way again. And therefore, he super motivated himself to never have to be in that position again. We're supposed to feel so remorseful for an ugly act that we committed, a rebellious act against God, that we never want to be in that position again. That vidui, first and foremost, brings that guilt feeling out. But it also springs a little voice in the back of our head saying that I don't want to have to make this confession again. It's a powerful motivation and inspiration offered by the act of confession of our sins. And finally, the Rambam. The Rambam, in his book of Mitzvot, he lists as Mitzvot Aseh, number 131, this declaration, this Vidui Maaseh, this confession of giving the obligatory offerings. And he says, and I'll quote you one sentence from the Rambam. He says, the reason why God gave us is this mizvah, shivanu lehitvadot lefanav, behosaat mishpatei ma'asot v'terumot, to confess that we gave our obligations as required, ulehitnakot mehem b'ma'amar, and to cleanse, literally naki, to cleanse ourselves of them, to absolve ourselves with verbalizing, with a statement, through words. Says the Rambam that this is very cleansing for us, that this statement where we're able to say, I've done what I was supposed to do, God, makes us feel great. It makes us stand before God and admit that we had an obligation and we carried it out. It removes a burden and a load from our shoulders, and it gives us pride, instills us pride that we indeed are the worthy and loyal servants of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And all these agricultural laws and all the details over the span of days and years of our life, I'm proud to say that I committed to them. And so to our vidui, confessing sins, making teshuvah, admitting, feeling regret, enumerating the different avirot that we might have committed, it absolutely, first of all, works. We know that. We believe that. And alleviates a heavy burden from us. It lifts a burden off our shoulders. It frees us of our past. It makes us feel, as the last word in the Vayabor, in the 13 attributes of mercy, the Yad Midot, v'nakeh, literally cleanses us. It allows us to move on with our lives and not sit and dwell in the past. To really know that a true Baal Teshuvah, one who repents, one who confesses his sins and does it to protocol with full heart, the system works. His past erases, and he really can move on. It is cleansing. It is powerful. It is healthy. And it is a gift from God, the fact that we have an opportunity to stand before him in vidui, in confession, and the process of teshuvah. This amazing and unique mizvah, vidui ma'aser, in this parasha, of course, has its practical purposes and objectives. It reminds us so much of and aligns so well to the mizvot and the obligations that we're right now involved in, leading up to that great, awesome day of Yom Kippur, which we'll have to stand before God in our own personal vidui. Shabbat Shalom.